Hello everyone, today we will be covering concept of screening. This lecture will cover screening and its types. It will be covering measures of validity, multiple tests, positive and negative predictive value of a test, and percentage of agreement. So what is screening? It is defined as identification of unrecognized disease or defect by the applications of tests, examinations or other procedures which can be applied rapidly, or it is defined as process of searching unidentified diseases, defect or any condition of ill health by means of rapidly applied simple tests, examination or other procedure in apparently healthy looking individuals. Screening tests sort out apparently well persons who probably have a disease from those who probably do not have the disease. It also helps in diagnosing disease or any precursor conditions earlier phase of their natural history or at less severe end of the spectrum that is achieved in routine clinical practice. This helps in gaining some time making the diagnosis at early stage, and this is known as lead time. It is an important factor when evaluating the effectiveness of a specific test. For example, usually carcinoma cervix remains asymptomatic in its early stage. In later stages, it presents with symptoms of abnormal bleeding, such as bleeding between menstrual periods, after sex, after pelvic exam, or after menopause. So if patient comes with the symptoms, it's already late and survival will remain shorter. If do screening, it is possible we can diagnose many such cases at their very early stage when treatment can completely cure patient for longer survival. It is the length of time between the detection of disease, usually based on new experimental criteria, and its usual clinical presentation and diagnosis based on traditional criteria. So it is the time between early diagnosis with screening and the time in which diagnosis would have been made without screening. What is the scope of screening? The main aim of screening is to reverse, halt or slow the progression of disease more effectively than would normally happen. Screening is also done to protect society even though the individual may not benefit. Screening is not only useful for identifying undetected cases, although that is its most common use. Screening can be conducted to control spread of infection, that is prospective screening. Also, in case if screening tools are applied to detect potentially infectious cases, for example screening for cases of fever at airport during global epidemic of H1N1. It can also be conducted for health education of community, as knowing is believing. Once people know that certain disease exists among their community members, it becomes easier to educate them about their method of prevention. It can also be done for research purpose to provide estimates of prevalence of disease and other parameters. Diseases which are apparent in community are not real picture, for example like diabetes, hypertension. Like iceberg, larger portion which is submerged, for example subclinical cases, carriers, undiagnosed, etc. And the floating tip is what the physicians see in their respective clinical settings. So, types of screening. Three types based on population group on which it is applied. Number one is the mass screening. When screening is conducted for whole population or its subsection is known as mass screening. For example, measuring blood pressure for all members of defined population and identifying hypertension among them, or measuring blood pressure among all adult males of defined population and identifying hypertension among them. Other examples of population screening are clinical breast examination of all adult women for breast cancer, checking all infants for hearing problems, etc. The second is the high risk or selective screening. When we conduct screening in a group which is at high risk of developing disease in question is known as high risk screening. Risk status for particular diseases can be decided based on past epidemiological research which indicate which group of population could be at higher risk for developing disease in question. We know people having high stress level are at higher risk of developing hypertension, so screening of senior professional in institute would constitute high risk screening. Other examples of high risk screening are mammography for women more than 40 years of age, retinal examination of diabetes, etc. Third one is the multiphasic screening. When two or more screening tests are applied together to assess particular disease status, then it is known as multiphasic screening. Example, undernourishment can be assessed through physical examination and blood investigations, for example, blood hemoglobin level, iron, etc. of a person. If these two methods are applied together to identify undernourished cases, then it is known as multiphasic screening. Apparently, multiphasic screening provides much better results. However, it should be carefully considered as it can require extra resources and may decrease population compliance. Criteria for selecting disease: it should be an important public health problem with high prevalence. Its pathogenesis should be understood. Should have method tool to recognize in early phase. Should be availability of tool for confirmation of disease and its appropriate treatment. Existence of prior evidence that early detection reduces morbidity and or mortality. Should be agreed on policy on when and what levels to treat. Expected benefits of early detection are cost effective. So when you are selecting a disease which should be screened, we should know the how prevalent is that disease. Means if it is more prevalent, then screening test is useful. Similarly, you should have the tool for confirmation also. When you are screening a disease, you are using a screening test. And those who are comes positive in that screening test, they must be confirmed with some other test. So to label them as a diseased. And for that disease, once you diagnosed, you should have an appropriate treatment. If you don't have appropriate treatment, then it's no use of doing the screening. And another point which is very important is you should do the screening of those diseases which are screened at early phases, and when you give the treatment, they have the better results. And if you look for the criteria for selecting screening test, it should be acceptable to all, should show consistency in its results, it should give same results when used again and again, and it should give valid results. We should also know that there is a one screening test and another is the diagnostic test, or we can say the confirmatory test. So what is the difference between these two tests? Screening test done on apparently healthy peoples, usually it is done on healthy population, and diagnostic test done on those with indications or those who are sick or those who are test positive on screening test. Screening tests are applied to the groups, whereas the diagnostic test is applied to the single patient. Test results in screening test are arbitrary and final, whereas diagnostic test, the diagnosis is not final but modified in light of new evidence. Diagnosis is sum of all evidence. Screening test is based on one criteria or cutoff point, whereas diagnostic test is based on evaluation of a number of symptoms, signs and lab findings. Screening test is less accurate, diagnostic test is more accurate, screening test is less expensive, Diagnostics tests are more expensive. Screening test is not a basis of treatment, whereas diagnostics tests are basis of treatment. The screening test, the initiation come from the investigator or agency providing the services, whereas the in diagnostic test, the initiative comes from a patient who comes with complaints to you. So these are the differences you should know, because these may be asked in various examinations. What is the difference between the screening test and the diagnostic test? So what we covered till now, we will have a diagram. So what is screening, when it is done, and what is the lead time? So now let's see. For example, I gave the example of cervical cancer. If we follow the natural progression of the cervical cancer patient, from here the cancer is onset and this is the progression of the cancer patient. So cancer patient arrived to your OPD round about here with symptoms. She arrived with the symptoms. Usually what we have observed, that this much the survival viable time. So you now take the scenario of screening test. This is the onset of the cancer and this is the progression of the cancer. You applied a screening test somewhere here. This is the screening test. Okay, and you have cancer which is detected. Now you see, if no screening test is applied, the cancer is diagnosed here. Okay, so the time between after applying the screening test and the time when usually the cancer symptoms appears and is detected, this is called the lead time. So this much time earlier you diagnose the cancer. You can see now the survival time has been increased from here. So if tests are applied here and diagnosis is done here and the treatment is applied here, then we can increase the survival time. So this is the role of the screening test. So now we'll be covering the properties of a screening test. Screening test to test should be acceptable. It should be reliable and should be valid. So we will be covering reliability, or you can say consistency, that is the ability of a test to give same results if repeated with keeping other factors same, and the validity of a test. The validity of a test is assessment of its accuracy to measure what it is supposed to measure. Validity of a test. Validity of a test is assessment of its accuracy to measure what it is supposed to measure. In other words, validity of a diagnostic or a screening test is ability of a test to differentiate between diseased cases from non-diseased cases. To be valid in true sense, it should be highly sensitive and specific. So what is sensitive and what is specific, we will cover. For example, this is a screening test and you are diagnosing the patient on diseased and non-diseased. Okay, diseased and non-diseased, and test is either positive or either negative. So vertical axis you have diseased patients and non-diseased, and horizontal axis in rows you have positive and negative. So those who are diseased and their test is positive, that is labeled as A, or you can say them true positives. But those who are non-diseased but test is positive, they are the false positives. And those who are diseased but test is negative, they are the false negatives. And persons, those who are non-diseased and test is also negative on them, they are called the true negatives. So from this we will calculate the sensitivity and specificity. So sensitivity is defined as the proportion of individuals with a disease that have a positive test results. So it will be A upon A plus C into 100. So it is usually expressed in percentage, for example 80%, 70%, which means the proportion of the test positives among disease subject is 80 out of 100. What is the specificity? It is defined as the test ability to correctly identify a healthy or non-disease subjects. So specificity is D divided by B plus D into 100. A test which have dichotomous results, positive or negative, the accuracy of a test is calculated based on the following formula. Accuracy is equal to sensitivity plus specificity, that is equal to A plus D divided by A plus B plus C plus D. And where prevalence of a disease is known, accuracy can be defined as sensitivity into prevalence plus specificity into 1 minus prevalence. So let's have an example to make it better understand. Okay, you have a village where population of the village is 1000. Population of a village is 1000, and you know that 100 people have the disease. People with disease are 100, and people with no disease are 900. Okay, we will make a table which I told you earlier. So we will make the columns of this is disease and no disease. This is test that is positive and negative. Okay, so we divide these. We know their total patients are 1000, the population of the village. So this is the 1000 here total, and we also know that 900 do not have the disease and 100 have the disease. Okay, and our test identified 80 patients with disease and test is positive, and 20 patients with the disease which test was negative. And here the test was positive and they don't have the disease in 100, and here these are the 800, and those who don't have disease also, and the test is negative. So this is A, this is B, this is C, and this is D. So we know that sensitivity is equal to A divided by A plus C, and specificity is D divided by A plus D into 100, and here also 100. So if we calculate sensitivity, that will be A, how much? 80 divided by A plus C is 100 into 100. So here this 100 gone, and it's equal to 80%. And if specificity is calculated, then that is D divided by A, that is 800 divided by 900 into 100. So this is 89%. So the sensitivity of our test is 80% and the specificity is 89%. So it shows that our test can recognize true positives 80% and true negatives only 89%. Now another term which we covered was accuracy. So I said accuracy is equal to sensitivity plus specificity. So how it is calculated? Sensitivity is A divided by A plus C. Okay, and specificity is D divided by B plus D. If we take example of the 2x2 table which we prepared earlier, so this is the disease, non-disease, this is the positive test and this is negative test. We said that 80 has the positive test and disease also. 20 do not have the disease but test is negative, and total disease were 100. Here 100, those who don't have the disease but test is positive, and those are 800 here, and those disease is not there and test is negative, and this comes out to be 900, and total we have 1000 population. So if we have to calculate the accuracy, then we will fill the value of A, that is 80 divided by 100 plus 800 divided by 900. So it will be 80 divided by 1000 into 100. So accuracy of our test is 88%. Though sensitivity and specificity are useful measures for evaluating the test validity, they are less helpful for a clinical point of view where disease prevalence in population is unknown. So validity of test, which means the ability of a test to predict disease among those who are test positive and non-disease who are test negative. If a person with positive screening test asks that what is the probability that I am having the disease, so this answer will be given by the positive predictive value and the negative predictive value. Keeping in mind the 2x2 table and you have the disease and non-disease, the positive predictive value will be given by A, those who have the disease and test is also positive, divided by A plus B, means the true positives and the false positive. So it depends upon the sensitivity and specificity and prevalence of a disease. For a given sensitivity and specificity, if the prevalence of disease increases, the positive predictive value will increase. The negative predictive value is defined as the proportion of the individuals with the negative test results that are actually do not have disease. So negative predictive value will be given by D divided by, so it means that how likely it is that a patient with a negative test results is truly unaffected. Let's calculate these two, positive predictive value and the negative predictive value. So let's make 2x2 table. From same example, so this is the positive, this is the negative test, this is the disease, and this is the non-disease. So here we have 80, here we have 20, so total is 100 here, here we have 100, and here we have 800, here we have 900, total is 1000, and here we have total on horizontal axis 180, here 820 on horizontal axis. So we said positive predictive value means a test who identifies the true positives, okay, among total positives by a test. So it will be, let's name them A, B, C and D. So true positive is A, and I told the total positives, that is A plus B. So take the example 80 divided by 180 into 100, so it's 8000 divided by 180, that is 000, and 800 divided by 800 divided by 18 is 44.44%. So the positive predictive value of this test is 44.44%. Negative predictive value, that will be true negatives divided by the total negatives by a test. Okay, so that will be D divided by C plus D, that is if we look up in our if we look up, that is D is 800 and the totals are C plus D is 820, so it will be 800 divided by 820 into 100, that is 8000, I think not 8000, that is 80000 divided by 820, so 1 1, and here we left with 8000 divided by 82 is equal to 97.56%. so the negative predictive value of test will be 97.56%. Yield of a test, number of previously unrecognized disease that is diagnosed as a result of the screening effort. So this is given by positive predictive value. It is dependent upon sensitivity and specificity and prevalence of the disease. For example, HIV testing among three different screening groups which have different prevalence. For example, a screening of blood donors, those who are giving the blood, they have the prevalence of 0.01% of HIV. Screening among RTI and STI clinic attending patients, they have the prevalence of 4% of HIV. And screening among intravenous users, those who have the prevalence of HIV 20%. Yield of the test will be different for different population. Let's have an example of yield of test. Scenario was blood donors, prevalence 0.01%. okay, so we have a screening test that is positive and negative, and these are the HIV positive and these are the HIV negative, and B have population of 2 lakh. Those are donors. Okay. If we take the prevalence of 0.01%, that means it will be 20. So 20 will have the disease. Okay. And here the negative test will be 0, and that it is 20 here. And okay, here will come the number 1040, and here the number will be 198960. So it will be here 1020, and here will be 198960, same, and the total will be here 199980. Okay, so prevalence we said 0.01%. Now we will calculate the PPV, positive predictive value, that will be 20/1040, means 20 is the true positive, and these are the 104 is the total positives. So it will be come out 0.019, that is equal to 1.9%. Okay, see, now the next scenario is among RTI or STI clinic, and prevalence was 4%, and we take sensitivity 100% and specificity 95%. This is same for the earlier example. Here we also took 100% sensitivity, that's why we have 20 positive cases and 95% specificity, that's why we have 95% of 2000 was 198960. Similarly, we take here also, and we will calculate for less population rather than calculation for bigger population. Here we have test positive, test negative, and HIV positive and HIV negative. So we take population of some 50,000. Okay. And if we have 100% this sensitivity, and we are calculating with the 4% of prevalence, that means our test will calculate 2000 here, and here 0. So it will be 2000 here, and specificity we are 95%, so 95% of the 50,000 will be 47,760, and here it will be 240, and here it will be 48,000. That is the 95% of the 50,000. So it will be here 2240, and here it will be 47,760. So if we have to calculate the prevalence, that is we calculated 2000 divided by 50,000, that is equal to 0.04, equal to 4%, which we took, and the positive predictive value is C, how much, that is 2000 divided by 2240, that is equal to 0.89, and that is equal to 89%. See, with 4%, how the positive predictive value is changed. Okay, now the next example which we can take, the prevalence 20%, sensitivity 100%, specificity 95%. So these are the intravenous drug users where prevalence is 20%. Okay, now again we make the 2x2 table. This is test positive, this is negative, this is HIV positive, this is HIV negative, and we take the population now 10,000. Okay, if we calculate 20% of the 10,000 will be 2000. Sorry, not 20%, but the 20%, because prevalence is 20 and our test is 100% sensitive, means he will recognize 20% of the total population with the test positive and they will recognize negative here 0, so it will be 2000. And if we calculate with the 95% of the specificity, so 95% will be here 95% will be the 8000, so this will be 95% of this will be 7960 and this will be 40, so total here will be 2040 and here will be 7960, and if we calculate the prevalence between 20%, so let's see whether it's 22,000 divided by 10,000 is equal to 0.20, and that is 20%. And if we calculate the positive predictive value, so positive predictive value is 2000, which is true positives divided by the total positive of a test, so it is 0.98, and that is 98%. So we can see that as the prevalence increases, the positive predictive value also increases with same sensitivity and specificity. So now your exercise is just do with the different sensitivity and specificity. Combination of test. When we use different test at different time, so either we can use simultaneously, that is the parallel, and we can also use the sequential, means series test, one then another. When two or more screening tests are performed concomitantly, then it is parallel testing, means at same times one test and another test. So this will give us the increase sensitivity. And when the second test is conducted after getting the result of first test, then it is known as the sequential testing. This is called the series testing, and this will increase the specificity of the results. So if the sensitivity is increased, they will give the true positives, and the specificity will be increased, then they will give us the true negatives. So consistency of a test result may be vary because of the following factors. It may change. One is the observer variation. If he or she is measuring the height of the same person 3 times, he or she may report 3 different readings all 3 times, and this is known as intra-observer variation. So it can be minimized by taking the average of all the readings, or you can say you take all the 3 readings and average them. Sometimes if 2 different observers take a measurement in same person, there is possibility of giving different results. For example, 2 doctors who read a scan report or blood pressure measured for same person at different point of time, so the 2 doctors can read same x-ray differently, or they can also take the blood pressure measurements differently. These type of errors is inter-observer variations. So we need to express extent of agreement in quantitative terms, means in quantitative terms how they are agreed for each observation. So how this can be minimized? This can be minimized by ensuring high standard of training and skills to them, and standardizing the criteria procedure for measuring or making conclusion. So let's see the example. There is a radiologist 1 and this is the radiologist 2. So you have given them the x-ray and you have to read them like abnormal, suspect, doubtful and normal. Similarly, radiologist 1 was asked also to read these x-ray, that abnormal, suspect, doubtful and normal. So this number A is both read as abnormal by radiologist 1 and radiologist 2. Okay, this number F is also read same as suspect by 1 and 2, and this K is read as doubtful by those 2, and this is normal P read by both has normal by radiologist 1. So if we have to calculate percent of agreement, so up to which percentage they agreed, then we will add this A, F, K, P and we will divide by the total reading into 100 and we will come to percent of agreement. So if we have to understand this, let's have an example. We have 2 radiologists, radiologist 1 and radiologist 2. So we have given them x-ray and we have asked them to write normal, abnormal, don't know. Okay, radiologist 1 will be reading them downwards, and that is radiologist 2 will be reading them horizontal. So here also radiologist will mark them normal, that is abnormal, and that is don't know. Okay, so radiologist 1 who is going this side, he read 20 x-ray normal. Okay, radiologist 2 also read 20 normal, but he also read, radiologist 1 read 10 normal who are read abnormal by radiologist 2, and here don't know 20. So these are, for example, 30 x-ray read abnormal by radiologist 1, and these are 30 read normal by radiologist 2. Here comes some figure 20, let's see 40 here, don't know why radiologist 1 is 50, here is 20, here is 40. So if we calculate total x-rays, this is 530 100, here 10 20 50, here 40 100. So 100 plus 50 plus 100 plus 50 plus 100, that is 250. So we have 250 total x-ray read. So percent of agreement has to be calculated, which are read normal by 2 and 1, abnormal by 2 and 1, and don't know why same by 1 and 2. So if we have to calculate, so it will be 20 plus 20 plus 40 divided by total 250 into 100, so is equal to 80 divided by 250 into 100, that is 800. Divided by 25, and that comes out to be 800 divided by 24, aad chuke, but 32. So this is 32%. They have percent of agreement only 32%. Another term, that is kappa statistics. So when two observers or two doctors or two specialists are measuring or looking after the same results, so there are two questions which need to be answered. To what extent their readings agree beyond what we would expect by chance alone? In other words, to what extent does the agreement between the two observers exceed the level of agreement that would result just from chance? One approach to answer this question is to calculate the kappa statistic that was proposed by Cohen in 1960. So what is kappa statistics? In order to understand kappa, we ask two questions. First, how much better is the agreement between the observers' reading than would be expected by chance alone? This can be calculated as the percent agreement observed minus the percent agreement we would expect by chance alone. So what the percent agreement we have observed, and we will minus the percent agreement which we expect by chance. So that is the numerator of kappa, percent agreement observed minus percent agreement expected by chance alone. And the second question which we need to answer, what is the most that the two observers could have improved their agreement over the agreement that would be expected by chance alone? Clearly, the maximum that they could agree would be 100%, full agreement, where the two observers agree completely. Therefore, the most that we could expect them to be able to improve would be 100% minus percent agreement expected by chance alone, and that will be the denominator. So kappa express the extent to which the observed agreement exceed that which would be expected by chance alone. Percent agreement observed minus percent agreement expected by chance alone, relative to the maximum that the observer could hope to improve their agreement, that is 100% minus percent agreement expected by chance alone, denominator. Thus, kappa quantifies the extent to which the observed agreement that the observer achieved exceeds that which would be expected by chance alone, and express it as the proportion of the maximum improvement that could occur behind the agreement expected by chance alone. So the kappa statistic now can be calculated by kappa is equal to percent agreement observed minus percent agreement expected by chance divided by 100% minus percent agreement expected by chance alone. Two persons are reading x-ray or scan or taking blood pressure. So if how much they are sure about their readings and what that these readings are not by chance, so we have to quantify that, and that is done by the kappa. So here we will take an example of mammography, that one is use digital and another mammography machine we use synthetic. So just see here, this is the synthetic 2D mammography, this is digital 2D mammography. So we have the reading of mammography, that is non-dense and dense, by synthetic also and that by digital also, dense and non-dense. So this is the arbitrary number which we have took, that these are 320 scans done. Synthetic 2D mammography calculated 180 as non-dense and in as dense, and similarly the digital 2D graphy who calculated 180 as non-dense plus 15 as non-dense, dense 10 and 115 also dense, which were leveled as dense by 2D. So if it's like the 2x2 table only, and this is sum of 190 towards down, this is also 130 down, and the sum is 195 towards horizontal axis, this is from left to right, 10 plus 150, 120, this is total number, and we calculate the percentage of 195 out of this. This is 320 here, that is 60%, and this is 125 here, this is 39%, this is 130 is 48%, 59%, 0.38. So what this means, if we have to calculate the percent of agreement here, that is we said, see here 180 which are leveled as non-dense by synthetic 2D and non-dense by the digital 2D mem, that is 180, and 115 are dense by synthetic 2D and also by digital 2D, that is 150. So 180 plus 115, these two divided by total, that is 92.1%. okay, so we know that 59.38%, which are 190, will be leveled as non-dense by synthetic. Okay, and these 59.3%, which are detected as non-dense by synthetic 2D, and these are the 195 which are detected as non-dense by digital 2D mammography. If he is sure, he is used synthetic 2D mammography, used its own criteria, and digital 2D mammography in used its own criteria, so the synthetic 2D mammography is sure that 59.3% of these 195 will be leveled as non-dense by synthetic 2D graphy, and 40.62% of these 125 was leveled as dense by digital 2D graphy will be leveled as dense by synthetic 2D graphy. Okay, so when we calculate this here, that 59.3% of this, okay, will be 115, and 40.62% of this will be 52.50. So the percent increment expected by chance alone will be 11580 plus 5250 divided by 30, that is 52.9%. Okay, and the kappa statistics will be 92.15, that is here percent of agreement plus minus 52.59, that is percent of agreement by chance alone, and divided by 100 minus percent of agreement except by chance only 52, that is 39, that is 84%. So kappa will be 84%, and this much they will be sure that they agreed by not only chance. Let's see how to calculate the kappa statistics by an example. So we took the example that here is the digital 2D and here is the synthetic 2D mammography. So non-dense, the dense red, here is the non-dense and here is the dense. So we saw that 180 are red, non-dense by both, and here is figure 10 and here is 15 and 115 are red as both non-dense by synthetic and 2D, and the total is 320 and here it's come 120, here come the 190, here come the 195 and here come the 130. So it's 195 or is 320, if we calculate the percentage is 60.94%, and 130 is 39.06%. Here 190 is 39.38%, and here 120 is 40.62%. Okay, so percent of agreement, if we have to calculate percent of agreement, that will be 180A, which are red, non-dense by 2D and also by digital, and 115, which are red as dense by 2D and dense by digital also. So it will be 180 plus 115 divided by 320 and into 100, if you calculate it will come out around about 92.19%. Okay, now this is the percent of agreement. What we have to calculate, that how much of this is by chance. Okay, so what we will do here, again we will make the 2x2 table. We will make a table. This is here we have digital 2D and that is synthetic 2D, and here is non-dense, here is dense, here also non-dense, here is the dense. We saw that total x-ray, which are red, are 320. Okay, And we also saw that 59.3%, these 59.3% are red non-dense by synthetic 2D. So if we ask synthetic 2D to read these non-dense X-rays, mammography, which are read by non-dense by digital 2D mammography, he will read correctly non-dense of this only 59.3%. Okay, so that will calculate, if we calculate 195 50, so we have to calculate 59.3% of 198. Okay, so it will be 59.38 into 195 divided by 100, so it will come out 117.79 and 40.2% synthetic 2D mammography will read as dense of these 130 of 2D. So if we calculate 40.62% of 130, that is 40.62 into 130 is equal to 528.06 divided by 100 will be 52.81. okay, so 52.81. so if we calculate here that he read 52.81 of 130 as, then 130 minus 52.81 equal to 77.19, and here is 130, and here we had 195. So 195 minus 195 minus 117.79 is equal to 77.21. So it's 120, and here is 190. Okay, and this is 59.38%, this is 40.62%, and this is 60.94%, and this is 39.06%. And now we will calculate the percent of agreement by chance. Okay, now we will calculate agreement by chance, and that will be 117.79, that is this figure and this figure, plus 52.81, divided by total number, that is this figure, that is 320 into 100. So if we calculate this 117.79 plus 52.81 equal to 170.6 divided by 320 equal to 0.533 into 100, so it comes out to be 53.31. So we have two figures, one is agreement by chance and this is agreement percent. Okay, so now from this we will calculate the kappa. Okay, so we will calculate the kappa now, that is kappa is equal to percent agreement which we observed plus, sorry, not plus, that is minus percent agreement by chance alone divided by 100% minus percent agreement expected by chance alone. So it will be percent agreement we observed, that is 92.19, that is 92.19 minus by chance, that is 53.31 divided by 100 minus 53.31, and that is equal to 92.19 minus 53.31 equal to 38.81 divided by, not 81, so it's 8 divided by 100 minus 53.31, that is equal to 46.69, and that is equal to 38.88 divided by 46.69 equal to 0.83, and that is 83%. Kappa came out to be 83%. So we saw in the example that how to calculate the kappa. So it gives us the percentage agreement. Consistency of a test result may vary due to biological variations, as we know that our body parameters follow some diurnal rhythms and there could be difference in measurements if you measure during different time of the day. For example, blood pressure, hormone levels, blood sugar, these can show variation at various levels of time. So we also can have tools, error in tools, so our methods or procedures, there is a possibility that instrument is not functioning proper, it is not calibrated, or some wrong reagents are used, which can give us the misleading results. Also have another problem, that is borderline. So when you are choosing a test, we have to choose a cutoff of a test that up to this value we will take as normal and above this value we will take that abnormal. So this cutoff value depends upon the disease prevalence. Then when the prevalence is high, screening level is kept at lower level, which will increase the sensitivity. Second, the disease. If the disease is very lethal, for example cervical cancer, breast cancer, and early detection can change prognosis, a greater degree sensitivity even at expense of specificity is desired. Those who are false positive can be ruled out by subsequent test. Useful index making this decision is the predictive value of positives, both true and false. See what is this borderline by an example. You have a test which distinguishes between normal and diseased. Okay, this is the value we showing the normals. Okay, and this is the curve who showing the diseased persons. So this are the normal and this is the diseased. Okay, these values are overlapping. Okay, these are disease but these are normal. Okay, so this area is overlapping. Okay, so this is the border line for normal. So the value from here to here will be the borderline value of a test. So we have to keep this in mind when we are choosing a screening test, that what will be our cutoff. In the last, how to evaluate a screening program. To evaluate a screening program, we can use various studies like randomized control trials. Ideally, evaluation should be done by randomized control trial in which one group receives the screening test and one group does not receive the screening test. Ideally, RCT should be done in same settings where screening is to be done. The second, we can use the uncontrolled trials used to see if people with disease detected through screening appear to live longer after diagnosis and treatment than patients who were not screened, like cervical cancer. And the other methods such as case control studies and comparison in trends between areas with different degree of screening coverage can be used to evaluate the screening program. If you have any queries, you can write to me. My email ID is akshay@healthandfamily.in, or you can subscribe to my channel on YouTube where you can get all the new latest updates on community medicine and lectures. And you can follow us on Facebook also. Thank you.